If you work in a laboratory environment, you probably have seen different types of safety hoods and cabinets that are used for different experiments or laboratory settings. All of these hoods and cabinets are designed for a specific type of work. It is important to be able to recognize each of them and understand the work performed in them. This video is designed to show how to properly use a biosafety cabinet to ensure the protection of laboratory personnel, the samples they are working with, and the environment. In a typical research laboratory, you may find isolators or glove boxes, fume hoods, laminar flow cabinets, or clean benches in biosafety cabinets. These are the different types of ventilation equipment used in a laboratory to work with biological materials or chemicals. All of these hoods and cabinets offer different types of protection based on airflow. It is important to know the difference between this equipment to use the most appropriate for your work. Let's take a look and see what is different about them. Isolators or glove boxes. Isolators or glove boxes are enclosed ventilation systems that can provide a controlled environment for handling chemicals. They do not provide a sterile environment. Inside the glove boxes, there is a working space that is completely separated from the environment around it. Laminar flow hoods or clean benches. The laminar flow hood is designed for sample protection, but does not protect the user or the environment. Room air enters the hood from the bottom front or the top side, passes through a HEPA filter, and then blows over the work area towards the user. This hood offers sample protection and can be used when the sterility of the sample is important and the sample is not hazardous. For example, for microprocessors, laminar flow hoods and clean benches should not be used when working with biological materials or chemicals. Fume hoods. Fume hoods are the most common type of hood found in ASU laboratories. The fume hood is designed to protect the user but does not protect the sample. Fume hoods protect users from volatile chemicals, toxic vapors, and flammables. A fume hood pulls air from the lab through the front sash of the cabinet and exhausts it outside of the building. A fume hood is not suitable for work with biological materials because it does not protect the sample or the user from biological hazards. Biosafety cabinets, or BSCs, can be found in laboratories where work with biological materials is performed. Biosafety cabinets are designed to minimize the exposure of laboratory personnel to aerosols or droplets when working with infectious agents or toxins. Biosafety cabinets are designed to protect the user, the sample, and the environment. An inward airflow creates an air curtain that, along with the sash, provides protection to the user. The sample is protected by a HEPA filter downward vertical airflow in a single direction and at a constant speed. The downward moving airflow splits in half before reaching the work surface between the front and back grill. This air split prevents cross-contamination of the sample. The air drawn to the front grill also forms an air curtain to prevent contaminated air from entering the work area. Biosafety cabinets protect the environment by filtering the exhaust air through a HEPA filter, which removes particulate contaminants. It is a requirement to certify the biosafety cabinet annually. The user should check the certification date and the magnahelic pressure before each use. Now let's take a look at biosafety cabinets in more detail. Biosafety cabinets are the primary means of containment developed for working safely with infectious microorganisms. They are designed to provide protection to laboratory personnel, the samples they are working with, and the environment when appropriate practices and procedures are followed. The HEPA filters will provide a sterile environment by removing at least 99.97% of particulates at 0.3 microns. HEPA filters do not remove gases and vapors. There are three types of biosafety cabinets, Class 1, 2, and 3, which are designed to meet different laboratory needs. Let's see how each of these biosafety cabinets work. In a Class 1 biosafety cabinet, the air from the lab is pulled through the front sash of the cabinet, providing user protection. The air is then recirculated inside the cabinet and eventually is exhausted through a HEPA filter into the building exhaust system or back out into the lab, providing protection to the environment. Generally, Class 1 biosafety cabinets are used for equipment or procedures that can generate aerosols. Biohazardous materials might be used when the sample sterility is not a concern. Now let's look at a Class 2 biosafety cabinet. In a Class 2 biosafety cabinet, the air from the lab is pulled through the front sash of the cabinet, providing user protection. Then the air is pushed through a HEPA filter downward over the work surface, providing sample protection. The exhaust air is filtered by a HEPA filter, providing protection to the environment. Class 2 biosafety cabinets are the most common in laboratories. They are used for biohazardous materials. For example, working with cell cultures, human blood and tissue, viruses, and bacteria. There are two types of Class 2 biosafety cabinets, A and B, depending on where the air from the cabinet is exhausted out to. In Class 2 biosafety cabinets type A, 70% of the airflow is recirculated back to the work surface. The remaining 30% is exhausted either back to the lab or to the building exhaust through a canopy. No flammable gases or volatile toxic chemicals should be used in this cabinet. In Class 2 biosafety cabinets type B1, 30% of the airflow is recirculated back to the work surface. The remaining 70% is exhausted to the building exhaust through a different connection. No flammable gases or volatile toxic chemicals should be used in this cabinet. In Class 2 biosafety cabinets type B2, 100% of the airflow is exhausted to the building exhaust system through a direct connection. In this cabinet, volatile toxic chemicals can be used in combination with high-risk biohazards. Always remember, it is not a substitute for a fume hood. A common feature in most biosafety cabinets is the ultraviolet lamps, or UV lamps. For years, the UV light was considered a method to provide a clean and sterile environment inside the cabinet when not in use. However, there are several limitations for the effective use of UV light for decontamination. For example, the lamp requires cleaning to remove dust and dirt. The germicidal effect of the UV light will decrease with more time of use. The UV light is not effective against all types of biohazards. The UV light will not reach any area of the cabinet workspace that is covered. For all of these reasons, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and the National Institutes of Health do not recommend or require UV light in biosafety cabinets. Next, we'll look at how to use a biosafety cabinet. How to use a biosafety cabinet. Preparing for use. First, prepare your standard operating procedures and lab protocols. Then, carefully plan your experiments, paying particular attention to all the materials and equipment needed. Pre-planning prevents crowding in the cabinet and the inside-out motions that disrupt the cabinet airflow. Put on appropriate personal protective equipment, or PPE. PPE protects you from the agents you are working with and prevents contamination of samples by skin flora. PPE at minimum should be a lab coat, gloves, and eye protection. Whenever possible, tuck lab coat cuffs inside the gloves. If the UV light is on, turn it off, then turn on the cabinet blower and light. Verify underneath the biosafety cabinet that the drain valve is closed. Check the certification sticker and ensure the biosafety cabinet has been certified within the last year. Check the pressure value reading on the magnahelic gauge and compare it with what is recorded on the certification tag. If the reading is equal or within 10% higher, the cabinet is safe to use. If the reading is lower, the HEPA filter might be damaged and the cabinet is unsafe to use. If the reading is noticeably higher, the HEPA filter may require service as it could be clogged with impurities or there might be other mechanical problems. In these cases, place a sign stating that the biosafety cabinet is not safe to use and notify your supervisor or lab manager. Allow the blower to run for 15 minutes before beginning work. This allows the air in the cabinet to complete a full cycle and purge any contaminants. After the cabinet has been purged, disinfect the interior surfaces of the cabinet with the appropriate disinfectant. Spray all of the internal surfaces and wait for the appropriate contact time, then wipe. Be careful not to allow your head to enter the cabinet while wiping. If using a corrosive disinfectant, follow with a wipe of 70% ethanol to remove residue. While the cabinet is purging or disinfecting, gather all the materials you will be using for your protocol, including absorbent materials and disinfectant for cleaning and for spill response. Decontaminate the surface each time before placing them in the cabinet. Avoid overloading the cabinet, as this will compromise its efficiency. Do not block the front or rear grill with any material or equipment. Set up the workspace at least 6 inches inside the cabinet. Good practice is to delineate a work area in the middle of the biosafety cabinet in front of you. Place items within close reach and position to limit crossing your hands when reaching for them. This helps to reduce airflow disruption. Create separate areas for clean items and waste, placing decontaminated materials toward the back of the cabinet. Adjust your chair so that armpits are level with the bottom of the sash. This will protect your face from infectious aerosols. Next, we will begin our work in the biosafety cabinet. Working in a biosafety cabinet. Before beginning work, limit access to the area around the biosafety cabinet to minimize disruption of airflow, airborne contaminants, unnecessary distractions, and talking. Conduct work in the biosafety cabinet by following good aseptic techniques. Avoid sneezing, coughing, or talking while working in the biosafety cabinet to minimize the spread of airborne microbes. Always make measured, controlled movements to avoid airflow disruption. Avoid extra movements such as getting up from the cabinet during work or adding or removing materials in and out of the cabinet. When transferring liquids or pipette mixing, always use slow and careful motions to prevent splashes and aerosols. Handle one sample at a time. Keep petri dishes, plates, flasks, bottles, tubes, and pipette tip boxes closed or capped when not in use. Transfer infectious materials and waste as far back into the cabinet as possible. Discard all contaminated materials in a bag inside the designated waste area of the biosafety cabinet. Close the bag and replace it when 2/3 of the bag is full or at the end of your work. Do not use a Bunsen burner or an open flame inside of the biosafety cabinet. Now that we've completed all of our work inside the biosafety cabinet, let's review how to clean the cabinet. Removing items from the biosafety cabinet. Once the work inside the biosafety cabinet is completed, wait 5 minutes in order to purge the air from the contaminants before exiting the cabinet and removing the items. After exiting the cabinet, remove your gloves and replace them with a new pair. Surface decontaminate all of your items inside the biosafety cabinet before removal. First, remove samples that need to be placed in incubators, refrigerators, or freezers. Then remove all other items except for waste. Collect waste in the biohazard bag, close the bag inside of the cabinet, and wipe with disinfectant before removal. Disinfect all cabinet surfaces. Turn off the light and the blower. Remove all PPE and dispose of the biohazard waste. Wash your hands with soap and water. Now, let's review what to do in case of a spill. Spill response procedures. If a spill occurs inside the biosafety cabinet, ensure the drain valve on the bottom of the cabinet is closed. Immediately cover any spill with absorbent material, such as paper towels. Also, place absorbent material around the spill to contain it. Pour disinfectant directly onto the absorbent material. Wait for the appropriate contact time, then remove the absorbent materials. After decontaminating the work surface, determine if the spill has leaked into the lower tray. To clean the tray, lift the work surface and flood the tray with disinfectant. Wait for the appropriate contact time before absorbing. While the tray is disinfecting, remove the work surface and all associated parts. Spray them with disinfectant and wait the appropriate contact time. Wipe down and reinstall all parts. After the spill is cleaned, continue with the usual decontamination procedure by spraying the inside of the surface with disinfectant, waiting for the appropriate contact time, and then wiping. If using a corrosive disinfectant, follow with a wipe of 70% ethanol to remove residue. Collect waste in the biohazard bag, close the bag inside the cabinet, and wipe with disinfectant before removal. For any spill, notify others working in the lab nearby and report the spill to the laboratory's PI and to ASU's Environmental Health and Safety. Maintenance and repair. The biosafety cabinet should be positioned in an isolated corner to minimize disruption of the air intake arising from traffic or drafts from doors, windows, ventilation, or equipment. Review and follow the manufacturer's recommendations for maintaining the biosafety cabinet. Work surface and interior decontamination should be conducted at the end of each workday. Removal and complete decontamination of the work surface, grills, and other parts should be conducted periodically. Any malfunction of the biosafety cabinet must be reported. Do not use the cabinet until you verify the repairs have been made. All repairs to the biosafety cabinet must be performed by a qualified technician. The principal investigator of the lab is responsible for ensuring the biosafety cabinet is certified annually. The biosafety cabinet must be certified by an NSF ANSI Standard 49 qualified technician. A new certification is also required after installation, moving, filter changes, and repairs. If you have any questions about this biological safety cabinet training video, please contact ASU EHS Biosafety at 480-965-1823. Or email biosafety@asu.edu. This has been a presentation by the Arizona State University Environmental Health and Safety Biosafety and Biosecurity Team.